So Michaela's example of a graphic syllabus was an instructor-provided tool for helping students develop a knowledge organization that's appropriate to the course at hand. Another strategy that leverages what we know about knowledge organizations is to ask students to represent their own knowledge organizations and then to refine them in some visual manner. And so one tool for doing that is what's often called a concept map. So these are some examples from Jennifer Osterhaag, who's at the University of Kentucky now. This was from a few years ago, she was doing a teaching as research project in a genetics course here at Vanderbilt. And so she had her students develop these concept maps as part of a study session. The idea with a concept map is that the students identify certain key concepts in a certain domain, right? It could be a whole course, could be a unit, could be a module. But they identify these key concepts and put them on the page somewhere. Then they draw lines between those concepts and label the lines with the relationship between those concepts. This is an example of this. This can be used to do that. This is a kind of super category of this other thing. So what's interesting about concept maps is, sometimes they can be a little more complex or less complex. As we saw, the knowledge organizations that we have internally are sometimes more robust in terms of connections and meaningful connections. So the idea of a concept map is to have students actually try to articulate in this kind of visible fashion how their internal knowledge organization is working. So not only does this provide the instructor with some sense of how students are thinking about things and how they're making connections or not, it also provides the students a prompt for developing and refining their own internal knowledge organizations as they kind of fiddle with the concept map that they're playing with. Now, here's another example. This was actually another student at Vanderbilt University, Ashley Setnar. She did another study looking at how students use concept maps. And I thought she had a really interesting analysis of concept maps. So what she did was she identified four key concepts for the unit that was being studied in this physics course. These were the most important concepts by her estimation. For each of the student-created concept maps, what she did was she calculated the average number of connections to and from those four key concepts. And so she had kind of a metric or a measure for each concept map that represented how many connections there were to these primary, most important concepts. And as you can see from these examples, some students had more connections, some students had less connections. What I thought was really fascinating was that when she looked at this metric, the number of connections to the key concept maps, and then compared that with the students' test scores in this course, there was a pretty strong correlation between the two. So this isn't the only way you can make sense of concept maps, but I think it provides some evidence to say that there's really something here, that when you ask students to create these concept maps, you're getting some sense of how they're thinking about things internally in a at least somewhat accurate way. Now, concept maps aren't the only strategy that you can use to try to help students develop their knowledge organizations and to communicate the organization of the material in a course. Another very simple strategy is what you might call signposts. So at the start of class session, let students know what's connected, right? So what topics are going to feed into today's class? At the end of class, tell them where this is going. Even within a course, within a class session, you can provide students with an outline of the topics that are going to be discussed today. It's kind of a smaller version of the graphic syllabus that Michaela shared. This is something that you can do in on the chalkboard, in PowerPoint slides, in verbal methods, frequently as you're teaching to help students kind of navigate where things are. There's been some really interesting research on how students take notes, and then when they're just sitting in a lecture hall and they're taking notes on what they're hearing, there were some interesting studies that showed that when students were provided with a graphic organizer of some sort, maybe an outline with blanks to fill in, or maybe kind of a blank concept map that they had to fill in, they actually were able to remember what they learned in the lecture at much higher rates because of that provision of a knowledge organization of sorts. The last strategy that I'll mention in terms of helping students develop more robust knowledge organizations is the idea of giving students open-ended questions. This gets back a little bit to the distinction between exercises and problems. If we're never asking students to solve more open-ended questions that require them to draw connections between different topics and concepts and techniques, then they're never going to have the opportunity to develop those connections in their own mental knowledge organizations. And so exercises are great, right? We have to have students develop some efficiencies, certainly. But we also can help them really expand their knowledge organizations and make them more robust when we give them questions that are a little bit more open-ended. And this may be it doesn't have to be questions that have never been solved or never been answered. It could just be questions that require students to kind of pull together a few ideas from different topics, or questions that permit multiple solution strategies. That can be very helpful for helping students see connections between things that they've studied so far.